Bethany, how are you?
Good. How are you, Jesus?
I'm doing good. I'm enjoying this weather. Better air quality here in
Yeah.
California.
Big difference. That's
Huge
nice.
difference.
Yeah. Can breathe. That's why we live here.
Exactly. Now, for those tuning in to the show, one, thank you for tuning in. And for those loyal listeners, thank you for your time and for your support. It means the whole world. Now, if you haven't subscribed yet to the show, you can subscribe on Apple Podcasts or any of your favorite podcasting apps. And then if you're watching this podcast episode on YouTube, my YouTube channel, Jesus McDonald, go ahead and hit the like button. Go ahead and subscribe. We're going to be pushing out valuable content just like this one here, which is with Bethany. It's a podcast interview, and we're going to be talking about marketing and promotional products. Now, I'd like to introduce Bethany Black to those that don't know Bethany. So, Bethany is a promotional product specialist. Okay. And she's been in the industry for what, Bethany? Almost 30 years?
Yep, close to it.
Wow. And Bethany started her business over 11 years ago, right?
Correct.
Yeah. And her style of promotional marketing requires creativity and out-of-the-box thinking. So you will never find Bethany bored, okay? She entertains herself with Pinterest projects, gardening, cooking, and projects like building a tiny house and remodeling a 100-year-old house with her son. Her greatest accomplishment is raising two kind, loving, and well-grounded children, Jonathan and Deborah, and of course, their newest sibling, who they claim is spoiled, a 130-pound Great Dane named Duchess. Bethany,
She's actually joining us right now.
is she?
Yeah.
Love
She's listening.
Also, to top all that, Bethany believes in being present, doing her very best to help others while staying true to herself. Please welcome Bethany Black. Bethany, thank you again for just joining the show and for your time.
Sure. Thanks for having me, Jesus. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, let's dive right into I have some questions for you.
Okay.
How did you get started as an entrepreneur and what's your story? Because everyone has their own story, right?
They should be theirs. They shouldn't steal other people's.
That's true.
So basically, I have always, my dad started a business, family business, when I was about 12. I started working in that business and helped him quite a bit. And then when I got married, we started a business. Actually, my ex-husband had started working for another company, and I kind of, about a year into it, said, "Hey, we can do this on our own. I can, handle." I think once you're an entrepreneur, you kind of know, like you can see real quickly how much more money you can make instead of, in sales or something like that, than taking cuts. And you're not afraid, at least I was never afraid to start a business and, put the capital out and be ready to take care of books and taxes and whatever is necessary, because I knew all that side. So we started a business, and then I got divorced about 11 years ago. And so I never had the opportunity to go to college. And so I kind of looked at, at the possibilities. It's pretty hard to get a decent job if you don't have a degree, especially in the Silicon Valley. So I thought, well, I'll start my own business. And that's pretty much how I started in
What made you
my own
choose?
company.
Yeah, what made you choose promotional products? Is that what you first started off as?
No, my dad was in the auto parts business, and then and I had done some computer programming and things with him, and then the business that my husband and I started, we were in the promotional product business, so it was something I was familiar with. Although I had never done the sales portion, he was kind of the face of the business. I had done all the back end part of it, and the graphics, and
Right.
so I knew how it operated. And and I always thought it was a fun business, because it's kind of new stuff, and
All right.
just having fun with it. So that was what, yeah.
What did you learn the most? Because there is something to say growing up with, you know, someone who's an entrepreneur or someone who's in sales, right? What did you learn, and did those things that you learned, did they help you in running your business?
Well, I think everybody approaches sales differently. I'm not one to like hype things up, or I'm more analytical myself. So, you know, I try to take a very, a very solid approach of why you might want to do this versus just, you know, this is really cool, this is a good item. I'm more of a problem solver. And so I think it fit well with Promotional, because there's not that many people that in this industry that really take the time to determine what the best product is for what you're trying to accomplish. So I'm more nuts and bolts and what, you know, let's figure out how we can make the most money with a campaign or something that we're going to do, put a program together versus just giving stuff away for free.
So that's really good, because I like the problem solving. And knowing you, you know, we've known each other for years. You do take the time to do research, to really, for lack of a better saying, count the cost on what is it, a product or service, where you're right, a lot of other people, and this includes me, will get excited about, you know, a product or service. This is the best thing on the market. You got to do this and that. And, you know, we really believe in it, right? And it doesn't mean you don't believe in it, but we just get so emotionally hyped up, right?
Yeah. No, it's a different, yeah, it's a totally different approach. Everybody's different, you know, in how they look at things. And I have a hard time hyping things up. If somebody comes to me like all hyped up, I'm usually like, okay, I'm the person that actually does go out and think about it. Cause you know, in sales, they always say, don't let the person leave, say they're going to go think about it. Cause it's like, what are they going to go sit in a corner and think about it? But I actually do. I actually sit down with a piece of paper and, you know, especially if it's a big purchase or something, you know, so I don't make emotional decisions. So when I sell, I don't sell emotionally.
That's a string. Trust me.
Don't buy or sell emotionally.
So why, maybe explain this, why are promotional products so important to any business?
Well, I look at it as there's no silver bullet in today's world. There's nothing that's, you know, probably 30, 40 years ago, you could pick something, Yellow Pages, and it was, you know, a good solid strategy and you could invest in that. Now, now you've got, you know, 10 different marketing streams you've got to look at. And I don't try to, you know, say that promotional products is more important than something else. But it is a marketing channel that everybody should use, mainly because of its potential. So there's no advertising available that if you hit it right, and with promotional products, you should be engaging all of the senses. So, you know, since it's a physical product, it should be engaging to, you know, the eyes, the sense of smell, the sense of touch, and your brand should be brought into that so that in the end, a person can actually remember the item, who gave it to them, what your message was for 5 years. And, there's nothing else quite as powerful as that.
But
you got to nail it. I mean, it's like, you know, if you're just handing stuff out to people randomly, that's not necessarily going to have the same impact.
Totally. Now, for those that are wondering where I got my Nike golf cap, baseball cap looking, with the Nike swoosh, Bethany created that product for us. And Bethany also created, the mugs too. Just a lot of products that, you know, we'd like to order for our customers, for our prospects, usually around the holiday season. It's a great way to stay ahead. It's a gift of gratitude. I love nurturing my customers a lot. sometimes more than normal. I just love it. I just love the customer interaction more than anything. But talking about, you know, promotional products and nurturing, right? When is it a great time to start thinking about promotional products for your customers and prospects?
Well, I mean, it's good anytime. That a lot of people look at year-end gifts. That's a big time that they think, oh, I'm going to, you know, thank my client, which is great, and you should. You know, you shouldn't go cheap. I remember working with a accounting firm, mm-hmm. and they, you know, came to me and said they wanted to give this $10 gift to their clients, and I asked them how much their clients were spending with them. And it was over $100,000 to, you know, close to $500,000.
What?
And I said, you know, yeah, I said, well then I don't feel, I said, I would rather just not do the order or sale. And they were like, well, why? And I said, because I think you're better off not giving a gift than giving one, because if you get a gift and it's a $10 item, then you think about the fact that I spent $500,000 and they gave me a $10 item, right? Yeah. But if you don't give them anything, they probably won't even think about it. So, I mean, I think that you have to match, you know, what they've given to you. Not like you're gonna give them $500,000, but give them something really a nice gift that they're gonna value. I like to do my year-end gifts at like the first of the year, and mm-hmm. because everybody's kind of inundated from Thanksgiving to Christmas with gifts,
yes.
and right? And
totally.
So it doesn't stand out. Yeah. So either do it like in September or in January, and you can just spin it saying, hey, we're starting a new year off. You know, I really appreciate your business last year, and I'm looking forward to having a great, you know, 2021 with you.
I really enjoyed that. And I'm super grateful for the advice that you gave me, because I was thinking about the same thing about, which everyone does, it's a norm, is I need to buy customer gifts. And I was looking through various products, and I wanted to shoot for somewhere between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Somewhere in that in between there is good. That way they get it before Christmas. They don't get it like on New Year's or some other day. And having that conversation with you really helped, because you kind of opened my eyes to, you know, making sure you stick out. Everyone's getting gifts around the holidays. You know, make sure you deliver them maybe in January so they get it mid-January or end of January, right? And you're right. I remember the emails that I would get, thank you, Jesus, or when we do like a, you know, follow-up because we have a website maintenance item with one of my clients, they would bring up the gift. They're like, thank you. I think one of the years we did water bottles, and they were just really just excited about it.
Yeah, I think we did personalized, if I recall.
Yes.
Which makes a huge difference. And it's really fun. You know, it's like, I have a similar thing I gave to my clients. I was talking to one of my clients on Zoom, and, he goes, oh, I have my water bottle, you know, he's like using a tumbler right there, and yeah. I held mine up. I had mine. So,
I still have mine. This is my tumbler. Look, this is my tumbler. Bethany, how long has it been? It's been a while.
Yeah, probably 3 years.
Yeah, it keeps cold and hot drinks the temperature that you want.
That's what you want. It's like, how many impressions a day is that tumbler getting for your client, for you?
Exactly. Like,
you know, 365 days a year, there's just no other advertising. And that's the thing. It's about who is your client? You know, it's like the difference, it seems simple, but it's like the difference between giving a tumbler and a water bottle.
Oh yes.
Is your client on the move all the time? Then a water bottle is great because they can put it in their car and stuff. Are they sitting at a desk most of the time? Then a tumbler is what you want. So it's, you know, it's all about identifying who they are, who that recipient is, and, you know, where they are, what item is going to be showing up day after day after day giving you advertising.
Yeah. Now, I'm definitely going to put a picture together with all the products you've given me and post that on Instagram. By the way, you post a lot of great products on Instagram. A lot of them are very modern. I know you had like the spinners. It's like a fidget toy. You've had that out like right when it was trending. So
yeah, I read probably 200 to 300, well, not probably more like 500 emails a day I go through, because there's new products coming out all the time. And there's not very many people in my industry. They put everything to junk. I do nothing goes to junk, because a lot of times it's that, you know, that unique product that's just hitting the market that you know, has come on. And I need to know about it, you know?
Wow. That's awesome. I don't know a lot of people that do that. See, this is about your personality, about wanting to know everything and research and reading all that. And you take the time to do that, which is very important. A lot of people don't take the time. They're just like, kind of like we're with Instagram. We just scroll. Yeah, that's all we do.
because I use this example to show you the power of a promotional campaign. Mm-hmm. I had a tree company come to me and say, hey, we want to do pens for a home show event. And you know, it's not, a lot of times I don't have a lot of choice. Okay, we're going to do pens. So I researched and found a pen that was made out of a twig. So now when they hand those out, yeah, there's a lot of things going on. They're associating the twig with the tree service. It's going to be very memorable. It's also something that's unique. It's not going to get thrown away. And they'll probably remember that tree service for 5+ years, because of just that one item that, you know, is a dollar item.
That's crazy. So, well, what has been, not to put you on the spot, but I'm just more curious, what has been your most impactful or memorable promotional product that really stuck to people and they couldn't get it out of their heads?
Well, that's what everybody asks that question.
They do? Because they want that, right? Obviously.
Well, yeah, they want that. And the thing is, it isn't the item. It's the messaging. Mm. And it's that combination. So yeah, you can have the greatest trendy item, but as soon as the trend's over, it's gone, right? But if you package it with the messaging, you can create a campaign around a paperclip and make it memorable.
That's true.
So yeah, it's about the messaging more than the item, and that's what people kind of get. They think it's more about the product, and while the product is important, and you got to factor in age group, the demographics of who you're giving it to.
Right.
It all comes together when you have that product that matches your message, like the tree, right? The tree
company
with the twig. That when it all comes together, then that's the power of promotional products.
Hmm. I like that, the messaging, because I was reading someone on LinkedIn and was saying how crucial copywriting is. And you can have the best looking website, you can have the best looking design, you know, artwork, but if the messaging is not on point and it doesn't really resonate with your audience, it's a waste of money.
Yeah, you're gonna lose.
It's a waste of time and money.
Mm-hmm.
So it's crazy. What we're emphasizing is messaging is really important.
Correct.
Now, I do have another question. So nowadays, how are you being creative with promotional products?
Well, nobody's physically meeting anymore. So, and there's no trade shows and things. So everything's switched to virtual events. So just trying to be creative. I mean, a lot of times they're saving a lot of money on venues and those kinds of things. So, or getting a booth or something like that. So how... Mm-hmm. How can you, you know, make people feel engaged in the event? And I think that's the real hard, that's the hard thing about virtual events, because I can sit at my office and I can be doing work and partially engaging, right, with whatever's going on. Whereas if I was at the event, I would be 100% engaged. Mm-hmm. And so I think that you can use promotional products to, you know, try to keep them engaged. I was working with a client and, you know, I thought it'd be fun to do like a coffee mug that you sent out to everyone, but make it unique. Maybe put a red dot on some of them, or a carabiner, or an engraving, spot. So nobody would really know because you're all separated. It's not like you're comparing mugs. Right. And then during the event, have, you know, different raffle thing, you know, prizes and stuff given to the people that have a blue dot on their mug, and randomly do that through, through the event so that people stay engaged, and it just makes it kind of fun and different. And, I think you, you just have to think a little bit outside the box. I know a lot of companies, you can send a box out, to people that are going to be at the event to make them feel, you know, maybe some popcorn while they're sitting there, or some food and, you know, a coffee cup and, you know, different things that
it's like a Netflix watch party, you know?
Yeah.
So what's your advice on how soon you should order that? Because you have shipping, you have a lot of things that come beforehand, right? And some clients, they just want the staples easy button. They're like, I want it now. And it's like, okay, you did not consider all these other things that come involved with it, you know?
Well, I tell people anything's possible. It's just how much do you want to spend? Because that's what they, people say, I want it now. And then they find out what overnight shipping is, $700 just to ship the item.
Gosh.
And then they're like, oh no, we can't do that. And so, you know, probably that's probably the biggest challenge with promotional products is it's kind of the last thing on the burner until it's the first thing, the most important thing, because, you know, I just delivered this morning awards for a golf event that they forgot to order and they called me Tuesday. And so, you know, I was able to get, some glass awards that turned out beautiful and stuff and hand delivered them because I don't trust UPS or FedEx right now. It's very difficult. And so, you know, a lot of times I've had clients off the internet call me and say that the internet company they're working with didn't deliver and, you know, they got an event tomorrow. What are you going to do? And I'm not going to be able to sell them anything, but we kind of brainstorm about who it's going to be. Is there something that we can print on their printer and I, you know, and pick up the item here or there and at least have something that they can hand out. And for me, that's what it's about. It's, there's nothing worse than a new administrative assistant that, you know, it's their first event and they don't have the item and their boss is going to be, you know, furious.
Right.
Versus at least helping them see, okay, well, we, you know, at least if you come with something, your boss will think, you know, that you're, you stepped out and really tried your best.
Right.
So that's my job is always to make the other guy look good.
Oh yeah. You do a great job. I know we talked before about, you know, our clients and I think it was around, you know, the nurturing program that I wanted to do with my customers. And you, I think you were, I called you one day. And this is a story to help you guys understand Bethany going above and beyond. I think UPS, there was like some kind of mess up with UPS. And we're talking, I think you were on the road and you had me on speaker, I believe, or Bluetooth. I don't remember. And I remember the thing that I do remember is you're like, UPS messed up the order. Or they're, you know, they're not going to be able to ship it or something like that. It was just some kind of mess up. And I'm like, okay. And you're like, yeah, Jesus, we can still talk. I'm personally going to pick up the item and I'm going to drop it off to the client. And I was like, whoa, you're literally delivering it to the client. You're like, yeah, because the client needs it. And this is not promoting that Bethany does this all the time.
Yeah.
But this is going above and beyond. That I was inspired by because I'm like, wow, this is customer service to like another level. And I never forget that. And it trusted, it built my trust on how you take care of my customers. And it's easy to refer you, especially because you have that passion, you have that care that is really hard to find in an individual. So.
Yeah. I mean, it's like I said, there's nothing worse than showing, you know, somebody's showing up and their stuff's not there. And that's kind of the downside of last minute ordering. Cause, and I try to explain that to clients. It's like, there are so many places that this can go wrong
right.
in a rush order, that I don't have control over. I'll do the, my very best, you know, to get it to you. I just, you know, if it's a one day, one night turnaround and then, you know, 2 days shipping with UPS. I mean, there's just so many things that you don't think about. There's, you know, fires in California, and so UPS right. can't deliver that day, or, you know, it's just so you always want to try and plan ahead if that's possible, and it makes it cheaper for everybody.
One thing I was listening to, I was having a conversation with this client of mine that has an e-commerce website, and he told me, and I don't know how much of it is true and how much of it is fear, but I know you don't believe the fears, so you'll see pass through to that. But he did tell me that, he said, go ahead, Jesus. Right now it's what, September 25th, Friday, 2020, right? He said, go ahead and order now for your Christmas list. I'm like, why? And he said, because you don't understand this whole pandemic, COVID-19, everyone is going to order around the same time, around Thanksgiving and Christmas. The USPS, they don't have the bandwidth. So if you order 2 weeks before Christmas, that gift might not show up on the front steps until January, because they're just going to be so backed up. And I don't know if that's true, but what do you think about that, or do you think it's true?
Oh, I think it's very true. It's been a nightmare. UPS, FedEx, you know, I've had two boxes that are shipped from here to San Mateo. One box gets there. It took 3.5 weeks to get the other box there, because FedEx had it all over California. You know, it's a constant problem. Everybody's having the same issue. So, and right now FedEx says we don't guarantee anything. And so they don't feel responsible at all, which is making it even worse. So yeah, I would agree with that. And I think you also have to factor in that, you know, they're looking at an increase in cases. So, you know, at these factories or other places, is there going to be sickness? Right. And that's the other thing that we've dealt with is a lot of employees are suddenly out of the factory and they can't produce the item. Or in China, when things were being shipped over, you know, China just kind of shut down their planes going out. And so suddenly an item that you should have had in 2 or 3 days was taking 2 or 3 weeks. So there's just so many unknowns. I would say plan ahead.
That's
crazy. If it's important to you. Yeah.
All right. It's crazy. Never thought about doing my Christmas shopping in September.
Yeah. You get better deals probably.
Yes, that's true. That's true. So you work with small to mid-sized companies, right?
Yeah, I prefer, a lot of my clients are corporations.
Okay.
Because they, you know, especially now we're doing a lot with HR. Mm-hmm. So like, because employees are remote, trying to make them feel a part of the culture still is important. And I think people are feeling lonely and isolated. So you know, you want to reach out and do that.
Right. And so, for a later date around the topic of employee awards and recognition, which that is a monster in itself, I definitely want to do a part two with you, a podcast episode around that, especially around things you should be considering for your employees when it comes to employee awards and recognition, because there's just so much and a lot of people don't know what to consider. Right.
Yeah. It's a huge factor now, because especially the millennial generation, they thrive on that, being recognized. And feel very lost if there's absolutely no recognition for the work they're doing.
Yep. I was just having a conversation with my wife, and yes, I am a millennial, and she's a millennial too. And one of the things that we talked about millennials, and something we all have in common, is authentic. Doesn't matter if you're in sales or marketing or whatever, if we don't feel like the relationship is authentic, automatically the trustworthiness goes down. And it's crazy because not a lot of generations think the same way. So, but that's one thing that I thought was like how authentic it is.
Why do you think that is?
I don't know. I didn't really dig more than that. That's a really good question.
Do you think it has something to do with, you know, you guys, you were the first generation to be in social media.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
Perhaps you created a lot of false relationships through social media to where authentic became very important.
That could be, I mean, that's a great assumption. I don't really know. I can see that because, yeah, Facebook was big during our time. I mean, it's still big, but it
not
was
to
really
millennials though. It's not big.
A lot of millennials. I mean, a lot of millennials probably just use it for personal use.
Mm-hmm. So Instagrams.
Instagram right now for millennials is, I would say, the biggest.
Yeah.
And then Snapchat is usually for teenagers, but Snapchat's not doing too hot compared to the other platforms. But yeah, millennials like visual. They like videos, and yes, authentic is a big thing. And I don't know.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to know too, because I consider myself a little bit more old school, where I enjoy the face to face, and I totally get because of the pandemic we can't do that. So this is as close as it gets to face to face is doing, you know, these podcast interviews over Zoom, right?
Yeah, I miss our Phil's coffee. Yeah.
So a lot of you guys don't know about this, but we would do business meetings, Bethany and I, before this whole pandemic, and we would go to Phil's Coffee because that was the spot where we would do our business meetings. And Bethany would get decaf because she's like, I can't do caffeine right now.
Well, remember, I got the right idea. Wait, I got the right idea that remember that they would fill your coffee. You could bring your own mug in and it got half price or $1 off or something. So
right,
I brought
right.
those two huge mugs, one for you, one for me, remember?
What was it, like a 32 or 42 ounce?
The one,
big old
I think
mugs?
The one you got, yeah.
Yeah. So we bring it in. She gets full decaf, right? No half cap. She gets decaf. I get full caffeinated, right? And I think I got like some kind of medium roast and I'm not sure what you got. And we're sitting down and I'm like halfway through my drink and we're taking sips. And then we just get lost for like, I feel like it was 5 or 10 minutes straight of back and forth. We were cutting each other off in conversations. And I'm like, hold on, Bethany. I caught ourselves. And I said, Bethany, I don't know about you, but my heart is racing really fast. And my hands are a little jittery right now. What is in this coffee? And you said, I don't know. I only had decaf. I don't even know if this is really decaf.
It wasn't. It wasn't really decaf. I knew because my heart was going too. So we were at another level.
That was another level. That was probably the most I've talked in any conversation.
Yeah, because it went on for another hour. So we had to kind of come off the high a bit.
The crash came. No, that was totally funny. Now, because we're kind of running out of time here, I definitely want to continue it on. But last question is, well, before the last question, because I did want to go back to asking about, you know, the mid-sized corporations, right, that you talk to. I mean, it can be big corporations. Is who is usually the decision maker? Is it like a marketing department? Is it like an events manager? I mean, who's usually the decision makers for promotional products?
Well, it's kind of interesting. There's a lot of decision makers. If I go into a corporation, they're buying promotional products generally from all different places, each department. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the HR.
That's true.
And
yes.
If it's a mid-sized business, I'll walk in and be like, there's boxes from somebody else. It's like, guys, come on, I can do that. They also don't remember, because we have over 800,000 products that we represent.
Right.
And so, you know, they think, oh, Bethany's the one that does the t-shirts, but they don't realize that I also do posters and I do mugs and I do, you know, and so what I try to tell them, touch the item and you want to put your logo on it, I can handle it. Mm-hmm. That's about the best way to describe it. So, the biggest decision maker I was using prior to pandemic was the event planners for corporations. It was kind of a new title the last four mm-hmm. to 5 years. Those have, since pandemic, I mean, it's tough if they've been kind of furloughed because there aren't too many events. But yeah, I mean, that's even administrative assistants to CEOs, they a lot of times make the decision. Interns a lot of times are brought in and they are allowed to at least research and then bring their stuff back to have whoever's in charge of, to make the decision. But it's a lot of marketing managers, sales managers, CEOs.
Gotcha. That's good to know. And then my last question, which is my favorite question, and I know you know how to answer this question as specific as possible because we've had this conversation, is what is your ideal client?
My ideal client is a marketing manager or event planner at a corporation that uses promotional products. So generally, a client that is going to use a minimum of like $5,000 a year of promo in their business, that's a good referral for me.
Nice.
Now, people have to realize is for me is like to do 100 pens and to do 10,000 pens is the same amount of work.
Interesting.
So what I learned is if I wanted to grow my business, I had to start taking on the larger orders because the small ones, you know, you can't get enough. I'll do them, you know, occasionally. And if it's a good client and so forth.
Right. It's not sustainable though.
Yeah, exactly. You can't live off of that.
Right. Totally get it. Now, if for our listeners that are interested in getting in contact with you and maybe they want to look at your catalog or they want to get in touch with you because they have questions in regards to promotional product for the customers or prospects, what would be the best way for them to get in contact with you?
You know, I ask my clients what they like. So some people like email and my website is prestigewebstore.com. And that has catalogs on it, virtual catalogs, also mm-hmm. online searches. And my email's on there and my phone number to reach out. So everything's there.
Awesome. So those that are listening on the podcast or watching this on a YouTube video, I'm going to go ahead and put that information. I'm going to put your Instagram profile because I love your images there. And if you're a millennial, jump on that ASAP. And then two, I'm going to put your website all in the YouTube video description area.
Well, thanks, Jesus. I appreciate it.
Yeah, my pleasure. I mean, that's what I do with most of the podcast interviews is because there's a lot of valuable information. But at the same time, I've been noticing that my audience also wants to get in contact with them, but they don't know what's the best approach. So that's why I bring up the question. Awesome.
Yeah, I'd love feedback on Instagram too, because it's kind of uncharted territory. There's not a lot of people in my industry doing it, but it seems like a good channel to introduce new products and items. So I'm totally open to hearing back feedback as far as whether millennials like it or, you know, because they're the main ones on there. So they find it useful.
Totally. Definitely leave feedback, guys. Well, we're out of time.
Okay.
We're definitely going to do a part two on employee awards and recognition. That one's going to be a really hot topic.
Okay. Thank you, Jesus. I appreciate it.
Yes.
Thanks for your time.
You too. You have a great one.
You have a good weekend.
You too.